moving ahead, what we have seen is a cell and cell form factor. We have also seen a building block where we know what is the current, what is the voltage. We also understood how parallel and series makes a system or a pack. Now, how to make a pack from the given cell? We have selected that cell. So, this is my cell based upon my requirement. Now, how to make pack from that? So, there is an example here. Consider a two-wheeler electric scooter is designed to have a range of 75 kilometers, which is common nowadays. If you want to have a range, you need to go for 50 to 75 or 80 kilometer. Okay? These two wheelers on an average consumes 16.5 watt hour per kilometer. And from here it is coming in chapter 2 vehicle dynamics. You go to drive cycle, you apply all the forces, and then you find out what would be the energy required to run per kilometer. So, we are not doing that calculation again, we are just taking a value. Now, depth of discharge is 80%, DOD 80%. I want always my battery to be charged or discharged between 10% to 90%. That means, I will never discharge my battery less than 10%, I will never charge my battery more than 90%. So, my overall depth of discharge is 80%. Now, there are auxiliary systems, horn, light. The new requirement in two wheeler is that you have to always switch on your headlights, or there has to be a light source always there. There is a brakes, and that consumes 2 watt hour per kilometer. Generally, it is irrespective of kilometer, but finally, when you look upon the range, we need to convert all the energy into watt hour per kilometer. So, what is our total energy consumption? 16.5 plus 2 watt hour per kilometer. So, it is around 18.5 watt hour per kilometer. For 75 kilometer, what would be the energy required? 75 into 16.5 plus 2, this would come approximately 1.4 kilowatt hour, approximately. So, to maintain a range of 75 kilometer, the pack energy is required is around 1.4 kilowatt hour. But then I have another condition, the depth of discharge should not be more than 80%. So, what I have to do, if I have to find out the battery pack energy, I have to divide this by 0.8. So, this comes close to 1.7 kilowatt hour. So, now what we know is the capacity of the battery pack. How do we how do we find about the current requirement? So there is another information what is given to us. Design a battery pack of nominal operating voltage at 60 volt. How does this 60 volt has come? This has come from the prime mover, from motor and controller. This requirement is coming from the prime mover. Motor says, I need 60 volt nominal. That means there is some plus, there is some minus, because this cell is going from 3.65 volt to 4.2 volt and the bottom side approximately 3.1 volt. The simple U capacity by voltage will give you the current rating or AH of the battery. Or so from there you can find out how many. Now you have a cell of 15 AH cells. So if you see 1.7, so 1700 watt hour divided by 60 is coming approximately 30 ampere. Actually, it is a 27, 28 ampere.
39.
Yeah. But my cell is 15 AH cells. So either I can have a 15 AH or I can have 30 AH if I put two in parallel, or I can have 45 AH or I can have 60 AH. So 29, this is where the engineering decision has to be taken. 29 AH, I can go with 30 AH. So that means the two cells will put it in parallel. Yes. There is a question. So we will come back to that one. We will come back to the, this is the answers. I am still in questions. I'll explain you this one. So the question is that he has gone to the answer of this battery pack parameter. He has gone, and then from the their question is coming, why the voltage you are talking about 60 volt, however the voltage comes only 58.4. Yes, I'll come back to that in few seconds. Okay. So what we require is two parallel cells to make it 30 AH. However, my requirement is only 29 AH, and I don't have a cell which gives me 14.5 AH. So here is the engineering decision. Can we have two cells in parallel? Can we go to 30 AH? Yes, we can go. It doesn't make significant changes, because 14.5 AH cells, if we have to get it manufactured, that would give, take my whole budget, profit, everything. This is available. I can use this. Okay. Now the voltage requirement is 60 volt. How many cells in series? So 60 by 3.65 will give me the number of cells in series. So what would be that? It would be slightly higher than 16. 16.4. So if I have to calculate series, that would be 60 by 3.65. So this comes approximately 16.4. Now again, now decision I have to take. Should I go 16 in series or 17 in series? Because it is in between. But we also know the cell voltage 3.65 is not a fixed voltage, it is a nominal voltage. It can go to 4.2 and it can come to 3.1 volt. why don't we use 16 cells? Where my lower limit, when I talk about 60 volts, it's not always 60 volts, it can go to 70 volts, and bottom side it can come to 50 volts. If my range of operation, if I can make between 15 to 71 volt or 69 volt, I am still good with the 16 cells in series. If this voltage would have been a fixed voltage, 3.65, no further changes, it cannot go to 3.7 or it cannot come to 3.6, then there was a problem. And if motor demands 60 volt pakka I need, then there is a problem. Then I have to either get my cell design, but no, motor can also run between some voltage limit. Yeah, so there is a question that why 16 cells we are taking, why we are not taking 16 or 17 cells. So the battery is designed to operate between some certain range. The minimum voltage for a cell can go up to 3.1 volt and the maximum range can go for 4.1 to 4.2 volt. So the whole battery pack can go between 50 volt to 70 volt. So if someone requires, or if my system requires a fixed voltage, so either I have to use a converter, mostly DC-DC converter, to get a fixed voltage output, or I can design the system, other system also, which can run between this voltage range. So generally what we do, we try to run the system between the voltage range. Major portion is, the major energy demand comes from the motor, and it can by design operate between the voltages. However, when you are coming to the lower voltage, your current requirement will go slightly higher. When you are going to higher voltage, your current requirement would be slightly lower. Okay. So now this is the engineering decision, what I have to consider. So I will consider 16 cells, because it still serves a purpose to me. So because of that, now what we have considered, 2P and 16S. Now if I put, so there are total 32 numbers of cells. Now if I put all the cells in one line, my battery pack will become very long, may not be desired, because I have a packaging constraint, my length cannot go beyond that. However, I have width available. So what we are doing now, we are converting this 32 cells into two rows. Each row will have 2P8S. Okay. Now it's easy. If I start putting cells in series, two parallels always, I can go like this and my bus bar can come like, so current will flow like this and my output would be at the same place. I don't have to put additional wire if it would have been in single row. So all those things we have to decide before starting the battery pack design, or during the design we have to think all the things. Now, the total number of cells in one row is 16, in two rows 32. The total weight of cell in cell, total weight 32 cells together, it is not one row, it is complete battery pack, is 10.24 kg. Now, what are the things I have to worry? Base plate, end plates, and side plate, which should be able to take this load, because my cell itself is weighing 10.24 kg. So let us move to the next slide, where we will see what are the forces acting on the battery pack. The forces acting on the battery pack, what are the forces? In the side strip, it is a tension, because it is trying to pull the plate, end plate. So it will get, it is trying to pull this plate in this direction to create some pressure on the cell surface. So since it is trying to pull this surface, the force acting on this side strip. Now side plate, end plate, if you talk about end plate, the end plate is constrained at the cell surface. the side strip is pulling it. Side strip is pulling here. It's a pulling here. Cell is giving a reaction force in other direction. What will happen? Now I'm pulling this side, and the some force is acting. What will happen? It will start bending. It will start bending like this. So that is why bending force on the end plate. Now, base plate, all the weight is acting on that base plate, and then this base plate is supported here, 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 and here. At this four places, the base plate is supported. Same condition, the reaction force comes at four edges. Now we are putting the load here, same bending will happen. So these are the basic forces what I am talking about. It does not mean that other forces are not acting, but this is the dominant force, and that is why we are considering that one. Now next slide, again one more thing here, the shear force, the when the bus bar is welded on the cell terminals, if there is any movement which is a continuous process when it is in operation in a vehicle, it will experience shear. So the forces what I am talking in this slide, side strip, end plates, base plate, the bus bar, these forces are dominant forces for that particular part. Now you understood what are the type of forces acting on that one. Now I am introducing a mechanical, basic mechanical term is stress strain theory, and the fundamental loads. There are five types of fundamental loads. Some of them we have already talked, but still I will take you back. This one is, this is an element, and the force, if force is acting like this, then we say it is a compressive force, or this phenomenon is known as compression. If it is pulling outside, then it is tension. If it acting perpendicular to the plane, then it is shear. It is all, how do you define plane, perpendicular and parallel, it is all on that. So I am defining this plane like this, and if I am forcing like this way, if the force is going like this way, this would be shear. Torsion, if I am twisting like this, that become torsion. And the bending, I am providing two force or multiple force from that and another out of line force, then it will bend. If I am putting two force like this and one force at the center, it will bend like this. So that comes as a bending. So these are the, anywhere, these are the five fundamental loadings or five fundamental forces acting on any element. Element is the smallest part from where we start doing all analysis. What is stress? Whenever you try to pull or compress, a body resists to a certain extent. And what we say, that is the internal resistance in the terms of force. And how do we define? It is a force per unit area, per unit cross sectional area. What is the unit of stress? It is a Pascal, similar to the flow. And why we are saying original cross section area? Because if you further keep on pulling, there would be some elongation. And because of that elongation, your cross-sectional area may slightly reduce. So the original cross-section, cross-sectional area. Now strain, because of action of the force, there would be some increase or decrease in the length perpendicular to your cross-sectional area. And the differential of that is known as strain. That means if L is your original length, sorry, L 0 is your original length, and L is the length after the force is applied, the strain is defined as L minus L 0 by L 0. Now, this would help, this theory would help several other places. This a terminology known as elasticity or Young's modulus of elasticity. That's a measure of how much it will extend or how much it will compress, how much the twist it can take, how much bending strength it takes. Okay. Let's move to the next thing. Let's start designing the base plate. What base plate has to do? Base plate has to take the minimum requirement of the base plate is to take the cell's load without failing, without cracking, without bending much. Because if it start bending, then I cannot constrain my cell. If I cannot constrain my cell, my bus bar cannot be constrained. If my bus bar is not going to constrain, it would lead to a failure of bus bar. Okay? So now, some assumptions. It's a continuous rectangular plate because my cells has stacked nicely as a rectangular plate of 134 mm, 134 or approximately 135 mm. So this we know already. After the arranging the cell, we already know that this is the dimension. What we do not know? We do not know the thickness of the plate, required thickness of the plate. So let's calculate everything else. The load is 10.24. The load is 10.24 kg. Multiply with g, that's mg becomes weight. Divide by the total surface area available, and that comes 2.719 × 10⁻³ Newton per mm square. And that is, if you multiply with the, this is all Newton per mm square is also equal to 1 megapascal. So multiply with 10⁶, that would become Pascal. So what we talked, thickness, then material. We have to select a material first, then only we can talk about thickness. Now we know the load, we know the area, we don't know the thickness, and we don't know what's the material. So there is a nice methodology to select a material with all your objective function. Objective function means what you require. Your strength is important, cost is important, insulative property is important. What is important? Or all those things are important. So there is a nice methodology by Asbe. It's known as Asbe methodology. There is a nice book. You can see here, Material Selection in Mechanical Design by him. If you get a time, go to that. However, I'll explain the methodology here. how do we select a material has basically four stages. First one is translation. Translation means you define your objective function. What is your objective? My objective here is maximum strength, minimum cost, minimum weight. Then you,
insulation
is my secondary objective. I can bring that as a primary objective, but right now these three are my so there is a question, insulation is not, is my primary objective or not? No, I have put it as a secondary objective. However, if required, I can bring that into primary objective. I'll show you how. Screening. Once you have your objective function, so what you want to do? Either you want to maximize that or minimize that based upon your requirement. What I want to do? I want to maximize the strength so that my thickness should reduce. I want to minimize the cost. So, 1 by cost I need to maximize. If I have to minimize the cost, so 1 by cost need to be maximize. I want to reduce the weight, that means density of the material. One by density of the material, if I maximize, my weight would reduce, correct? Because mass is directly proportional to the density. Then you rank whatever material you have, you put all those objective functions there, maximize or minimize depending upon this, and then rank. If you are putting a maximize function, then the highest the rank you should select. Now, if you have two materials of the same ranking, what you should do? Then your secondary objectives comes into the picture. Like insulation. So, what we do? We index material, known as material index calculation. For base plate, it is basically flat. So, for flat plate, what we need to do? We need to maximize strength, basically. We need to minimize the thickness. So, the deflection, if you have seen my earlier slide, bending force, what it does? The base plate also bending force. So it will, there is uniform loading. So, where would be the maximum deflection? At the center of the plate.